Jerome, welcome everybody. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. It's we're all getting used to these really, really international events, and it's really nice to know that there are people from California to China really following. So welcome to everyone to the second day of our last week of this event dedicated to Mark of Partition and Young Towers. And we're very pleased, I'm very pleased to present the first speaker of today, Jerome Bouzy from CNRS Orsay. Is it still called Orsay, Jerome? Everybody's so confused about the names of the universities.
Well, let's keep it for the, okay. For the comments, since it would be quite long.
Okay. And he's going to talk about the dynamics of smooth surface diffeomorphism and continuity of exponents. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Stefano, for organizing this conference and the school and the whole activity and inviting us. So, yeah, so I will talk about this joint work with Sylvain and Omri. Actually, it will be a kind of a running joke, since they will talk about what follows tomorrow and the day after that. And probably, I don't know about tomorrow, but certainly the day on Thursday, you will understand why it's relevant for the topic of the workshop. Okay, so, but yeah, it will be. Okay, the talk will be organized like this. First, I will recall some definitions and the basic results about exponents and entropy. Then I will state the main results. After, I will try to explain a little bit what goes into the proof, and I will give an application to another proof of a theorem of Burguet. Okay, let's start. So the first object we want to consider is the top Lyapunov exponent. So we'll have a closed manifold with some Riemannian structure, a smooth diffeomorphism on it. Usually you should think that R is infinite. And then we'll consider the space of of probability measures, or invariant probability measure, or ergodic and invariant probability measures. And we always use the weak star topology as usual. Okay, so the top Lyapunov exponent at one point is the growth rate, is this growth rate of the iterates of the norm of the differential, in some order when you iterate forward. If you have a measure, then the top Lyapunov exponent of the measure is the average of the pointwise quantity. Of course, since this pointwise quantity is invariant, if you have an ergodic measure, then it's almost everywhere constant, and that's the value you want to think about. Okay, so this is the pointwise presentation. Of course, there is it's very well known for a long time that you can also compute this average top Lyapunov exponent with these formulas. Okay, and the point of this is that you see immediately that since it is an infimum of so these are integrals of continuous functions, so they are by definition continuous. The value of these integrals is by definition a continuous function of the measure in the weak star topology. Therefore, since you have an infimum of continuous function, you get an upper semi-continuous function. And in fact, here we don't need C infinity. C1 is just, of course, enough. Okay, so that's the, we have a personal continuity. Okay, it's well known that you do not have a lower semi continuity. One way to get, one standard way to get a counterexample is to consider a generic diffeomorphism in a Newhouse domain. So with a robust heteroclinic tangency in some hyperbolic set. I don't want to go more into details. Well, it's well known that you can approximate, let's say, an aperiodic orbit, hyperbolic orbit, by ones which have weaker and weaker exponent. So you, you can get, it's upper semi, the Lyapunov exponent, the top Lyapunov exponent is upper semi continuous, but not lower semi continuous. Okay, now the other guy is the entropy. So let me recall a few things. So you have the notion of dynamical balls introduced by Dinaburg and Bowen. And it was introduced by first to compute the topological entropy. Okay, that's what you can call one of Bowen's formula for entropy. And Katok, as it is well known, introduced this show that you could also use this kind of ID to compute the entropy, the Kolmogorov-Sinai entropy of an ergodic invariant measure. Okay, so what do? You fix a scale epsilon that you will let vanish. And for given scale, you consider how many of these dynamical balls you need to cover a set of given measure, let's say one half, it doesn't matter because mu is ergodic. And you take the gross rate and you are in business. Okay, if the measure is not ergodic, you have to take the average of this quantity. It's not like in the, so that's one of the drawbacks of this thing, but okay. So you have this way of thinking about entropy that you can keep in mind. And the first thing, so here we also have upper semi-continuity. It's a result of Newhouse based on Yamdin theory that tells you that if you are infinitely smooth, then actually this entropy map on the set of invariant quality measure is upper semi-continuous. Okay, so it's a little bit like the exponent, but of course the assumptions are not the same and the technique is completely different. And again, you don't have lower semi-continuity. Here it's even easier. As soon as you can approximate a measure with positive entropy by, let's say, a periodic orbits, then you see that it is not lower semi-continuous. Okay, so we have these two players, the entropy and the exponent. They are both upper semi-continuous, but not lower semi-continuous. So now, of course, it is known that there are really classic relationship between the two. I mean, in particular, Ruelle-Margulis inequality, okay, that I have recalled here, that tells you that the entropy is bounded above by the exponent. Well, I should add a further plus here. This is the maximum of the top Lyapunov exponent n zero. Today what we are going to see is that for C infinity surface diffeomorphism, actually we have a similar relation, but between the continuity of the two quantities. So what do I mean by that? Okay, so we start with an ergodic case of our theorem, where you can see it's more easy to understand what's going on. So you have your C infinity surface diffeomorphism. You take a sequence of ergodic invariant probability measure, okay, by extracting, if you like, you can assume that it converges weakly to some measure mu. Okay, now you make the assumption, which is not automatic, that this limit is ergodic. And what we claim is the following. that, okay, you consider the ratio between the limit of the entropies of the new case and the entropy at the limit of the limiting measure. Okay, so of course this limit doesn't have to exist, so you, but you can further extract to make these two limits converge. And now there is a real assumption, okay, which is that we want this limit, we need this limit to be positive. Okay, so it is something that will come regularly and that is really necessary for what we do, that we need this entropy not to go to zero. Okay, so this is what we assume. And now we have these two ratios. Since the functions are both, I mean, the entropy and the Toplyapunov exponent are both upper semi-continuous, these are numbers between zero and one. Okay, and we claim so that the continuity of the entropy is not worse than the continuity of the Lyapunov exponent. Okay, what do I want to? So this inequality, in some sense, I mean, if you formulate the problem in that way, of course, it is sharp in the sense that, okay, if you give me two numbers, alpha and beta, which satisfy this inequality, so, okay, less than one also. Okay, you can find examples which satisfy, so that you observe these two ratios, okay? So that's the main result in the ergodic case. Okay, let's see some consequences. So the first consequence is like advertised, as advertised, that if the along the sequence you're considering the entropy is continuous in this sense, simply that of course it means in the previous theorem that the ratio will be one, and therefore the second ratio for the exponent also has to be one. So this is what we call entropy continuity. Of course, because of the examples I gave or I suggested, in most cases, you never have true continuity of the exponent, but we have continuity in this sense, which we call entropy continuity. That is, if you have a sequence of ergodic measure which converge so that the entropy converge, then converges, then the Lyapunov exponent has to converge too. Okay, so why this will be important for the rest of our work that Sylvain will and then we will present. It's because it is a kind of rigidity in high entropy, by which I mean the following, that, okay, still in always in the setting of infinity surface diffeomorphism, let's take it topologically transitive with positive topological entropy. We know by our previous result that there is a unique measure maximizing the entropy. It is, so then if you take a sequence of measure, ergodic measure, which approximate the topological entropy, okay, so first by upper semi-continuity, you see that the measure nu k have to weakly converge to this unique measure of maximal entropy. And then when you apply the main result, you see that not only you have weak star convergence, that is convergence of all the averages of continuous function, but you also get convergence of the Lyapunov exponents. Okay, that's another nice simple application is to Hausdorff dimension. So if you have a measure, you can, well, I don't know why I wrote it like this. I think it should be invariant measure for us, but okay, it doesn't matter for the definition. The Hausdorff dimension of the measure is the infimum of the Hausdorff dimension of the sets with full measure for that measure. Okay, so you have a function on the space of measures. And now what we say is that this, if you restrict to the set of ergodic measure with entropy bounded away from zero, then the Hausdorff dimension is upper semi-continuous. Okay, the proof is to use Young's formula, we have in dimension two, for this Hausdorff dimension, and then use our result about continuity, our main result. Okay, yes?
Sorry, can I ask a question?
Sure. Everybody is welcome to ask a question.
No, I'm just trying to digest this, your entropy continuity. So maybe you mentioned something in the previous slide. So if your sequence of ergodic measures is all Dirac deltas on periodic points, then the conclusion holds also, right? So it means that, no, because you're assuming that you're,
well, so, you don't know. It could be, well.
This fact that the limit is positive entropy is part of the assumption of the curve.
Yes. We need that. It's an assumption. So having the entropy, the limit of the entropy to be positive by Rayle's inequality is enough to get the positivity of the limit of the exponents. But the assumption that the entropy is bounded away from zero is really an assumption. Okay, because you see, you could imagine that in fact, you, for instance, in the problem of Hausdorff dimension, that you would get, that you would have measures with bigger and bigger dimension, but it's because the ratio between the entropy and the Lyapunov exponent goes to one, but both are going to zero. And this we cannot say anything about. And you could imagine that, okay, is this ergodicity assumption really necessary? Well, we can pretend to do away with the ergodicity assumption of these measures. I'm not speaking about this one for now. But here you see that the assumption would become that we want almost every ergodic component to have positive entropy. Okay, and since you quote me, I will confess everything at once. you see, this set is not necessary. Well, probably it's not a compact set because here I'm assuming ergodicity. And I could probably weaken that to, I could remove ergodicity, but then I would have to say that all the ergodic components have entropy bounded away from zero, and then I'm in trouble again. Okay, let's say it's mainly for advertisement purposes.
But so in your first corollary, the entropy continuity.
Yes.
Okay. So now this is for different morphisms, right? So it doesn't apply, for example, to quadratic family and so on. You don't get anything like this, right? So I'm thinking,
I'm not sure. We do not claim it. I think it's possible, but we do not claim it. As you said, what we say is for C infinity surface details.
So suppose you have a sequence of periodic orbits converging to the SRB measure, for example.
Yes.
Then this corollary holds, right? Then you're saying that because the entropy of the SRB measure is positive.
No, but you need the entropy of the measures that are converging to be also positive and in even lower bounded.
Oh, you need the entropy of each new k also to be positive.
Yeah, you need the limit, yeah.
Not just the limit to be positive.
Well, it's
the limit of the measures.
entropy, not the entropy of the limits. It has to be because the assumption is that they are equal. But
I see. So it's part of the assumption is that the limit of the entropies is positive, which means you cannot have all zero entropies in here.
Okay. Yes, it's when you want to think seriously about SRB measure, that's a big issue.
But so if you're, sorry if I continue, I don't want to take up too much of your time, but if you're approximating by horseshoes, if you're approximating the SRB measure by horseshoes, then this will by uniformly hyperbolic invariant sets, then this would apply, this corollary, right?
Yes, I think that, yeah, if you have fatter and fatter horseshoes, then with the entropy lower bounded, so they are really fatter. I mean, the entropy should be lower bounded. This is what I can say.
Right.
Then yes, it will work.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. So yeah, by the way, for everybody, I didn't say it, but questions are welcome. So now let's do away with the ergodicity assumption on the limit, which is not very natural. So now we still have a sequence of ergodic measures that converge. Okay, this is in some sense for free, since you can always extract, but the limit is just some invariant measure. And then you have a statement that I did not want to show you first because it's a little bit difficult. For me, at least, it's a little bit difficult to see whether it means something or not. So you have a decomposition of the limiting measure. Okay, this is what is written here. So mu zero and mu one are two invariant probability measure. You have some beta, which is just the mass of mu one. And then what we claim is that the limit of the top exponent of the new k is beta times the top exponent of mu one. Okay, and for this same number of beta. And the limit of the entropy is bounded by beta times the entropy of that same mu one. Okay, so if mu is ergodic, then of course, ergodic measures being extremal points, these measures have to be equal. Okay, so mu one is equal to mu. So you see here that the first equation just defines beta. And then the assumption is still there. I mean, the positivity assumption is still here. So you can divide and you get back the result of the it is really a generalization. Okay, we'll see that it's so one nice application of this generalization is let's say this contribution to the thermodynamical formalism of SRB measure. So always you have to fix a threshold with this approach on the entropy, but then you have equivalence between existence of a Sinai Ruel Bohen measure with entropy at least H, and the fact that if you compute this kind of, I don't know if I dare to call it a topological pressure. So here you see this difference is the measure theoretic pressure of an invariant probability. Okay, with respect to the geometric potential. Okay, and then what we do here is that we take the supremum over all the ergodic invariant measure with this bound, this lower bound on the entropy. And what we say is, so what is known, this is Piessine's formula, is that if you have an SRB measure, then for this measure, you will have that this quantity, so the pressure of the measure is zero. Okay, which is just to say that you have equality in Ruel's inequality. So that's Piessine entropy formula. So this is this let's say that this is a case in the okay, or well, some version of Piacine, if you want to say Piacine was talking about volume, but it's Piacine formula. What we prove is the other direction, just so then you have to, I don't want to, then it's an exercise to see that, if you will be able to get, you will consider a limit of a good sequence of measure, and then you will see that, you have to see that, the sum of the ergodic component will have to satisfy the Piacine formula and therefore be SRB measure. Okay, so that's let me see.
Sorry, yes. Why is this a corollary of the theorem? How does the SRB measure come into the theorem?
Oh, it comes because here you see that you get, so yeah, well, I forgot a little bit about it. So you
get a subsequence that converges.
Yes, certainly.
This converges to zero, then you decompose the converging measure, right?
Yeah, and you get one, and you get an integral of the pressures, okay? And you know that this integral is zero, from this inequality, okay, and then you look at this ergodic decomposition. You know that's okay. You have measures which are not hyperbolic, okay, but they cannot be sinks because where you are taking a weak star limit of measure with positive entropy. Okay, so what remains is measure that could have a zero exponent and a positive exponent or two zero exponent. Okay, but this one they have, so that they can contribute. What am I saying? Sorry. So anyway, you look at this ergodic decomposition, yeah. And you check that you have a part which is where you just see zero equals zero. So this doesn't give you an SRB measure, but you don't care. And the remaining part has to contain an SRB measures. Okay, so sorry, I'm a little bit too excited now, but yeah, so that's, so now let's, unless there are other questions or comments about the statement, now I would like to explain the proof. So the proof use some ingredients which are quite standard, like this trick of using a projective extension of the dynamics, which goes back to the very early study of Lyapunov exponent. I wrote some names. I mean, this is the basic part. So what is it? This projective extension is just above each point x. We consider the set of one-dimensional linear subspace, so the set of directions, okay, and then you get another smooth manifold of dimension three, and on which you have the extension, the projective extension of the map is this f hat, which is what you think, okay, and now what you can define is the dilation of the map of the differential in a, not only on a point, but in a given direction, just with this formula. Okay, and since we are in dimension two, and we will be looking at hyperbolic measures of Seidel type, we are really looking at one-dimensional unstable. So the expansion, when we are going to look into is one dimensional, okay, and therefore it's just an additive process in the term of this function phi, which has the very nice property, obvious but nice, of being continuous on this projective extension. Okay, so now when you're looking at an ergodic and hyperbolic measure, okay, by hyperbolic, I always will mean a saddle type. Then you can say, okay, do I have lifts? Yes, I have lifts, that's this compactness, but I can be very precise about the lift. So in fact, you have two invariant measurable graph. So the unstable, the graph of the unstable directions and the graph of the stable directions. They are both defined over some measurable subset, which has full measure for any hyperbolic measure. It is just measurable. Okay, that's usually, that's life. That's actually why we have something non-trivial to say. And then you have each of these invariant graph gives you, so which is defined almost everywhere, in particular with respect to mu, defines unstable lift, this mu hat plus, and a stable lift in this mu hat minus. Okay, just you just lift to the one of the two graphs. Okay, the graphs are invariant, everything is fine. Okay, and now the connection with the Lyapunov exponent is that the top Lyapunov exponent is the average of this of the dilation with respect to the lift, the unstable lift. Okay, and of course you have the same type of formula for the bottom Lyapunov exponent, which you can, I leave the definition to your imagination. Okay, it would just be the average of the same function to the with respect to the unstable lift. Okay, so now we have these measures and this continuous function and the Lyapunov exponent are averages of a continuous function with the right lift, at least in the ergodic case. So now when we have our little problem with a sequence of ergodic measure nu k converging to some measure nu, so we lift the new, we want to deal about with the top Lyapunov exponent. So we consider the unstable lift. Okay, there is some k that should be here. Okay, and perhaps after extracting, it will converge to some measure mu hat. Okay, which will be an invariant probability for the projective extension of f. Of course, by continuity of the projection between this projective extension and the initial manifold, mu hat is a lift of mu. Okay, so what we can see, what does it, so for now we have in some sense just a nice translation. Okay, what does it say? It says that the limit, what is the limit of the top exponent of the mu case? Okay, each exponent is just this average. Okay, since now it is an average of a continuous function, it is by definition of the weak star topology above the average of the limit function. Okay, so now there is no more discontinuity. Well, what is going on? Okay, what is going on is that we didn't say which lift is mu hat. So everything is encoded here. Okay, so in the ergodic case, we can be, it's easier to see what's going on when mu is ergodic, when the limiting measure is ergodic, then by this theorem or this classical lemma, we know that we have only two lifts, two ergodic lifts, sorry, of mu. Okay, any lift is a combination of the ergodic lifts. So it is, okay, this is what is written here. It is a combination with some alpha, so alpha, a convex combination, of course. So alpha is some number between 0 and 1. Okay, what does, then when we write this, what do we see? That the limit of the exponent, okay, we do some trivial computation, which I hope is still correct. Okay, and so you have you should compute mu hat of phi. So this is 1 minus alpha nu plus hat of phi, which is lambda plus of nu, plus alpha times lambda minus of nu. Okay, then you, here it is, we are looking at saddle type thing. So lambda minus of nu is minus its absolute values. And you do your thing the way you want to present thing. And here, to get close to the formulation of the theorem, I make this coefficient beta appear. And this coefficient beta is this strange number. Okay, so what is the takeaway from this little computation? It is that so this quantity here, or the fact that beta is not equal to one, the defect between one and beta, the difference between one and beta, okay, what accounts for it? It's the fact that we had measured, carried by the unstable graph, is gamma plus. And in the limit, some of the mass, alpha in these notations, leaked to the somewhere else. Okay, but the only place it can go is the, well, in fact, this is not, there are two places. Either it goes to contracting, or it can go to anywhere when the two exponents are zero. Okay, so that's the interpretation of this thing. And now we want to use that. So now what is the game? The game is to use the discontinuity of the exponent, which we understand as this leaking of mass. You can also think about it as some kind of a quasi homoclinic tangencies, to say that, okay, we'll have this leaking of the mass. We want to, from the stable to the unstable. Okay, so what does it mean concretely? It means that you are looking at the unstable, and there are points, there are some measure where it gets very close to the stable direction. Okay, it corresponds to the fact that we are looking at a non-uniformly hyperbolic system. So the unstable direction, okay, most of the time it expands, but sometimes it contracts. Okay, and here we are looking at a limit of ergodic measure. So it means if we see in the ergodic decomposition of the limit a negative exponent, it means that there are very long stretches of time where new k generic points actually, or new hat plus k generic points above, they represent a direction which is expanded most of the time, but for very, very long time, they get very close to the stable direction, to a stable direction, and now it contracts for this very long stretch of time. And now it goes to some other part of the measure of the space where it expands. And at the end, we have this combination of the two exponents. Okay, so now the game is to use this to get a bound on the entropy of the measures nu k for k large. Okay, that's what we want to try to do. Hey, are there any questions?
So I'm just trying to see, how do you deal with the fact that mu might not be ergodic with respect to the assumptions you stated before?
Oh, so here what I will just say is that, what I'm going to tell, so actually it won't appear explicitly. That's a little bit of the, I don't know, the magic of stupid algebra or something like this. Okay. It will appear in this beta. So let us, so it's, so for me, it is helpful to think about the ergodic case because then I understand what is going on. I understand exactly where things come from. In the general case, it's much more it's more complicated. So we won't need to make it completely explicit. What you could have in mind is that, okay, you are converging to an ergodic to a measure with a non-trivial ergodic decomposition. This ergodic decomposition, think about it as being finite. Okay, it's measurable, so okay, you can break it up. Okay, what does it mean then to converge to have an ergodic measure very close to a non-ergodic one? It means that for a very, very long time, because the limit, the ergodic component of the limit are invariant, of course, so they correspond to, so when you get close to them, you could also formulate this in terms of sets, open set approximating measurable invariant subset. Because of the invariance of the limit, when you get close to it, you stay there a very long time, but still, if the limit is not ergodic, it means that after some time, you escape and you get close to another part. Okay, so in the ergodic case, when downstairs it is ergodic, what you expect to see is that for a very long time, you are close to some compact subset of big measure where the graph, the expanding graph is continuous and you expand at a definite rate. And if you look at the right iterate given to you by, I don't know, Seledet's theorem or just the definition I gave of the Toplyapunov exponent, you will see expansion at that rate. And then you have very, very long intervals where you are close to the unstable guy, to the stable guy, sorry. And then you see contraction at the rate given by the negative Lyapunov exponent. So now you have many, many ergodic components. So you will see a combination of all these things.
So I'm trying to see if this intuition I'm trying to develop is true. You explained to me now why, if the limit is not ergodic, you can find geometrically sets which carry interesting ergodic components. But I wonder if you consider the measures as just a couple of the Toplyapunov exponent and the entropy.
No. Well, what happens is that, well, generally, if you look at the lift of an arbitrary invariant probability measure, what you have is just that the over each ergodic component, you have a lift. For the ergodic component, which are hyperbolic, you just have the combination of the stable and unstable lift. Okay, mm-hmm. For the other component, it is more complicated. It depends on the cases. You have, there are works on classification of these things where sometimes you have no decomposition. Sometimes you still have some kind of parabolic phenomena, so you have only one direction to which is invariant. So it's complicated. We don't want, but we focus on the hyperbolic situations, but then you have a combination. Okay, and you don't necessarily have all the stable or all the unstable lift. You have a mix between the two. So it gets complicated, but it will turn out that we don't need to get too much into this, into expliciting what is going on. We'll see.
Okay, thank you.
But yeah, but that's the idea is this. You are converging to an ergodic decomposition. This ergodic decomposition is invariant. So you see the various behaviors with the proportion given by the decomposition, but you see them you see each of them for a very long time.
I see, thank you.
You're welcome. So, okay, so that's the weapon for to not to have to deal with this problem, or at least to in a rather simple way. It is to, so we consider pieces of orbits and we say that they are neutral if you do not see any expansion or if you see only very small expansion. So gamma is a small positive number. So I don't know, it is much smaller than something. Okay, L is big. Okay, the main thing is gamma. So so remember phi is the dilation. Here, what I have written, I don't know why there is a parenthesis here, is to say that, okay, when you iterate one time, two times, three times, any number of times until from the beginning of the interval until anywhere in the interval, what you see is a contraction. So it's like a hyperbolic time. Okay, but it's hyperbolic, not in the sense that it gives you expansion, but in the sense on the contrary, that you do not see expansion. Gamma is small. Okay, so in the ergodic case, what will happen is that you have these stretches where you contract because you are very close to the stable direction. And I should make a little picture. Okay, so this is time. Okay, this is a very, very big time. Okay, and now there are intervals where you see contracting behavior. Okay, let's call it lambda minus. Okay, I have a pen. It will be easier for everybody. Okay, you have this lambda minus. Okay, and then, so, okay, you need to consider some iterate, and once you do that, essentially, you see all the time, you see a contraction by this lambda minus. Okay, so therefore, you see a contraction when you start, when you continue. Okay, here you only have contraction, so I'm only interested in what's. But now when you go further, you have some time where even if you're in lambda plus, okay, let's say that all over here you're in lambda plus, still when you start to do your business from the beginning here, you see globally a contraction. Okay, this is exactly, okay, this corresponds to the fact that the Lyapunov exponent, the negative Lyapunov exponent, will cancel a part of the positive Lyapunov exponent. Okay, this is what we saw in the little algebra by calc computation, where we had this factor of something like this. Okay, we had not only the mass, but okay, and when we have something like this, okay, we call it a neutral block. Okay, so for technical reason, we don't want strong contraction. We tolerate a little positive contraction, and we certainly need to have a bigger intervals. The one which, and this should not be a problem because we are converging to something invariant, blah, blah, blah. So now what we introduce is a, okay, so we have this, think about the generic points for UK, for the measure, the ergodic measure on UK. Okay, and what we will select in them are these neutral blocks. Okay, so the neutral blocks, they have a nice property that if you have a union, if two neutral blocks intersect, then their union is a neutral block. Okay, just because here you have one, so everything is good there. Okay, but if you have another neutral block from here, okay, then you say, okay, until this point, I use the fact that the first interval is a neutral block. And now the average between here and here is small, and now when I want to go further, I use the fact that the second interval is also a neutral block to complete, to see that between this time and any of these times, I still have no expansion, this neutrality. Okay, so therefore you can always take the maximal, if you wish, in your mind to have a clearer picture. You say, okay, I can always assume I have I'm looking at a maximal natural block. Okay, I'm considering measures for which the exponent, this is the top exponent, it is not a sink that I'm looking at. So therefore, the average for a very long time will be positive. So I cannot be in an infinite natural block. I can just take the maximal natural block that I see, and they will be finite. Okay, and so I can define what it means for a point to be in a natural block or segment. And this is this chi alpha n. Okay, and now I can frighten you with a formula, which is in fact not so complicated.
Excuse me, Jérôme.
Yes.
What is the alpha quantifier?
Sorry?
What is the alpha?
Oh, sorry. Alpha is gamma.
Ah, okay.
Okay, I got used to use, in the paper we use alpha, but here alpha was used for this leak. So sorry, yeah, thank you. Okay, so now, I see the time is running out. I don't want to. So now what we see is that, so what we do is we have this typical this generic point for nu k hat plus, okay, this is this x hat. We look at we fix alpha, sorry, gamma and L so that we have a notion of natural blocks. We see the maximum natural blocks and we only keep those. Okay, so it's like an empirical measure, but you only keep those things, okay? And I'm a little bit, here maybe I made a mistake. Okay, so let me paper over it. Okay, so you select these natural blocks and you take some limit, okay? And you want the parameters to go so that you get longer natural blocks, okay? And that the expansion you tolerate is weaker and weaker. Okay, so let's pretend that, this formula is not completely correct. I try to, but okay. So in this way, you get a measure at the end. Okay, if I didn't put this, I should get the measure in UK, hat plus. Here I will get some which converge to the mu hat, to the measure mu hat. So here I would get mu hat if I didn't put that. Okay, here I will get a measure which is part of mu hat, which is dominated by mu hat. Okay, and okay, and then now what is the natural decomposition is to say that I can do that. And of course, so okay, I need some condition which will be more or less automatic if I'm looking at generic point. So since time is evaporating, I will not talk about this. And now you have, of course, you need to go to a subsequence, but you can ensure that you have a natural limit. Okay, this sub-probability, this invariant sub-probability M0 hat that I tried to define before. And of course you have mu hat. Okay, so which will be this, yeah. Okay, so the first thing is to see that you can make these things converge. Okay, it's an exercise in a diagonal argument. And things like that. And now you just get your decomposition, but above where it makes the most sense, just by saying, okay, mu zero hat, so one minus beta is the mass, total mass of this natural part. Okay, what remains will be beta times mu one hat. Okay, of course, if beta equals zero or one, you have some things that are not well defined, but you don't really care. And now what are the properties? The properties are that first, okay, the measure, the natural limit, it is made of very long. So first you selected very long blocks. Since these blocks are very long, this was the parameter L that goes to infinity, the measure you get are invariant in the limit when L goes to infinity. Okay, so you get invariant probability measure. This is what I should have said at first. So the first thing is that when you have a natural block, the average, of course, of your dilation is less than gamma, which is going to zero, so it is less than zero. But you took these intervals to be maximal. So in fact, it's not less than zero, it is equal to zero. And you can check that it goes to the limit. Okay, the condition is that if beta is equal to one, mu zero hat is not really defined. Okay, so you don't pay attention to that really. And this, the second thing is that you can exhaust all the zero thing, and you will get that for the other guy, the mu one hat, almost everywhere, these limits are positive. Or if you wish, the ergodic component of mu one hat have a positive, define something which is expanding. They have a positive exponent. Okay, so you have this decomposition. Okay, that's where the decomposition comes from. Okay, and now I have 2 minutes. Okay, so this, so now we are going to apply this to our entropy estimate. So we do like in Katok theorem, but along unstable manifold, okay, using disintegration along the unstable foliation. Okay, that's, we are going to use, so the smoothness will be used to work following Yamdin by using parametrized curve and not dynamical ball. Especially we will use curves that with speed that never vanish, that never vanishes, so we can lift them to the projective bundle. Okay, and so now we have this this piece of curves inside of which we want to keep track of a set of positive measures for this disintegration, that there will be a set of measures which are typical of points which are typical for the measure. Okay, so now what is the idea? You apply your dynamics, okay, and you see how things separate. And essentially now the goal is to use the natural blocks to say that during the natural blocks, nothing happens. This is clear in the tangent dynamics. Okay, that's the definition of the natural blocks. You expand almost no, you have almost no expansion. Okay, so if you start with something small, the diameter will not expand. Okay, so, but you have to be, so I won't talk about Yamdin. So the first thing is that you will, the first thing is this epsilon hat. So it tells you that you want to have a small diameter above so that the curve is almost straight. The tangent doesn't get wild, okay? So you will be able to control the expansion by looking of the piece of curve, by looking at the derivative at the speed anywhere on this very small piece. This is the epsilon hat. And now that you have control below, this control below will control, sorry, this epsilon hat above will tell you that you control the expansion below from the dilation, okay, which is small since you are in natural blocks. But of course, you can do that once, and then you will start to, you want to do it again, but you have lost control maybe of what's going on above. It is not because you are contracting below that above it doesn't start to oscillate after some time. So this is where you use the second parameter epsilon to say that, okay, most of the time, so I am always in the measurable graph, the unstable measurable graph, okay? But most of the time, I am in a compact part of it, okay? And therefore, I can assume that I am looking at a continuous graph most of the time. There, of course, there are exceptions. We are doing ergodic theory. And now we use this modulus of continuity to say that, okay, if we take epsilon very, very, very small given epsilon hat, we will still control the what's going on above after applying some iterate of f. Okay, and in this way, we can see that when we are in a neutral block, we do not have to subdivide our small curve very much. I mean, some number, but which will be exponential with a small exponential, like is usual in Yamdin theory, is behind this capacity of going from small diameter to small number of smooth reparameterization. Okay, so now, okay, since I am, I think I am already over time, so I will just tell you very quickly. So we have built, so we started from this sequence of measure, we built a decomposition above, okay, and this, and using this decomposition and the argument I alluded to on the slide before, we get something like this. That is a cover of a piece of unstable manifold with a significant measure, okay, by a small number. So this is where we use the fact that we do not grow during the natural blocks. We have this beta. Sorry, one minus beta is the natural blocks, and then during time beta, something else, we have to use something else. What we use is that we are copying the measure mu one, so, but only during a fraction of time beta. So you have this beta factor here, okay? And we still keep the size of everything small. Okay, so really once we have this small, this reparameterization by curves with small images, we really have a control on the entropy by this fibered Katok formula. Okay, and the conclusion of all this is that the limit of the entropy is bounded by what we want. Okay, that's half the theorem, actually it's the big half. The second half is that, okay, what is the limit of the exponent? Okay, but the limit of the exponent is mu hat of the dilation. Okay, but in this sum, the first term gives you zero. Okay, we saw that it's the essentially the average over natural blocks, so it's a zero. Over maximal natural blocks, so it is zero. So this, there is only these terms that remain, which gives beta times this top exponent of mu one. Okay, and when we to do this seriously, not only I need to say that mu zero hat gives a zero contribution to the dilation on the average, but I also need to say that mu one hat of phi is the top Lyapunov exponent. We may be careful here; it's not mu plus or something like that. So the reason for that is the last property in the neutral decomposition, that almost every ergodic component of mu one hat was hyperbolic. So because of that, it tells you that you have, it is really the top exponent that you are seeing all the time. Okay, not sometimes, not something strange. Okay, so this gives you the general statement. Okay, so Stefano, how long do I have?
You can take another couple of minutes if you want, but we don't want to be too late.
Yeah, okay.
Break.
Okay, so let me just say it very quickly then. So recently, David Burguet proved a fantastic result, which is just there on the slide. And okay, after he told us about that, we realized that actually, so he has a stronger result than what I have put here on the slide, but this part of the result, which still is nice, we can also, we obtain another proof by applying the reparameterization arguments. Okay, that I have tried to give you some idea of. Okay, so we are using his result to make you read our paper. Okay, so yeah, I don't want, so it's a preprint on archive. As I said, Sylvain and Omri will tell you why it is so, it is related to the workshop. And so, thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, well, we can take a couple of minutes for some questions, if there are any.
I have one quick question. Is there any chance of doing these kinds of things for flows? The obvious kind of question in three dimensions.
So I think that when you are in codimension one, it's possible, yes. That so when the unstable dimension is one, probably it's doable. Okay, you see that okay. Here, everything happens because we are working on curves. Okay, so we have something that is additive once we are on curve. So it looks like it shouldn't be too much trouble. I mean, we haven't done it and we haven't, okay, maybe there are some difficulties, but it seems reasonable. Beyond that, it looks much more difficult. And maybe there are other examples.
I also have a question, Jerome.
Yes, yes.
So actually, I have two questions. One is similar to the question you was just asked. In your paper, you explain why your result is not true in higher dimensions if you take a surface and a product with a system with many zero entropy measures. So you would have many measures of maximal entropy. But what happens if you impose on a higher dimensional system that the measure of maximal entropy is hyperbolic? Then I assume the problem would not be with the correctness of the statement, but how to control stable manifolds geometrically. So I wonder if you think this can be overcome.
So yeah, I'm not sure. I'm not sure. Well, what you have, okay, so first probably you need, okay, you have these examples where you have measures of maximal entropy of different indices. Okay, like these circle bundles studied in particular by Rodriguez-Hertz, Tazibi and Oes. So here you have measures with which, so if you just, so then it you need something. But what I would say is that it's possible that, you need to this, so, okay, you need to do something more. Also, you need to restrict, to put some, instead of just assuming that you, so for instance, in these examples, you can make them work. If instead of just assuming something about the entropy, you say, okay, I want to fix the index.
Okay.
Then for this example, which are very special, and in some sense, they evade your question because they are partially hyperbolic with center dimension one, you can get a lot of things, but I don't know in general.
But what is the obstacle? What prevents you from extending this result to higher dimension?
I don't know. I know the technical obstacles, which are,
technical,
as I said, we are doing something one dimensional. So probably it works in any dimension if you have only one positive Lyapunov exponent. I'm not saying I know how to do it, but it looks like the same type of techniques could work, at least might work. But then in general, I don't know. If you are really I don't know if I would like to say, okay, let's assume that you have a situation where the measures of high enough entropy are hyperbolic, maybe with a fixed index. This could be a setting where it might work, but I don't really know.
So for example, if one fixes an ergodic homoclinic class, like in Rodriguez-Starcibe-Nouris, then the index is fixed, and you have the topological transitivity that you need for uniqueness, and then the question is...
Okay, if it's, yes, it could be, but I don't really know. It's...
Okay. And my second question is even more annoying. You explained how to make the reduction from the case where the limit is not ergodic to the case where it's ergodic. It was quite geometric, and I wonder if you tried to find a more naive reduction, or once you found the reduction, you stop, because it feels like perhaps one can... In this setup, it seems like you only consider measures which are identified by the Lyapunov exponents and the entropy. So you could just divide, let's say, two measure classes, and you take some measure and you divide its ergodic components in such blocks. And then if you have a sequence which converges to a measure, you have a subsequence which accumulates in a block. And the size of the block can be arbitrarily small, and you find in the end, a subsequent which goes to an ergodic component or something slightly more naive like that. I wonder if you thought about it and it's not possible.
Well, I don't know. It's
Well, I just want to say that I'm a big fan of this program. So thank you for this talk.
Well, thank you for your questions and your attention.
Thank you very much, Alon. Okay, so thank you.